Hello and welcome back to South Park Explained on No Bullshit. Today we're finally wrapping up season 22 with the finale episode called Bike Parade. This one is not only the culmination of the entire 2018 season of the show, but also this is the conclusion of a two-part story arc about Amazon taking over South Park. Previously we were left with a bit of a cliffhanger. Most of the town was protesting Amazon, led by a Marxist-pushing former employee, Josh. Last episode he was chewed up and spit out into an Amazon box while working there, and he's been campaigning against the company ever since. Meanwhile, the boys prepare for a big, high-stakes bike parade, like the episode's title. But for a minute there, Stan, Kyle, Kenny, and Cartman weren't going to have their bike supplies in time because of the protest. Fortunately, they wound up making a deal with Jeff Bezos, the leader of Amazon himself. The boys found him new workers from the mall, who had turned into mutants since no one had shopped there in ages. Yes, things are looking up for the South Park boys. They're close to their goal, but there's still a lot to do before they can win that bike parade. So, with all that said, let's go ahead and rejoin them now and see where this story goes from here. Okay, so Kyle and his friends start getting their packages. Naturally, their parents become suspicious, asking questions. When they start to explain how they helped Jeff Bezos, we cut to a room of Jeff listening to their conversations. All of their houses have those Alexa things in them, so technically Amazon is listening. South Park just likes to amp things up a bunch here to make things hilarious. Bezos is all creepy while listening to them with headphones on, listening on an old radio setup for some reason. Looks like it's from an old movie, maybe The Conversation with Gene Hackman, or that Frequency movie from 2000, something like that. Regardless, we see Bezos listening in and gathering information on the town to help with his eventual plans to take it over. This, of course, is a carryover from the previous episode too, and as we go on, this finale touches upon and wraps up a large number of story threads from earlier this season. It also gets pretty meta later on too, towards the end, even referencing South Park's own place in television and pop culture, in the landscape. Speaking of previous things coming back, next we cut to Randy Marsh's farm. He's been growing and selling weed there this season, but apparently the business wasn't doing too well. His wife Sharon even says they were only getting like 2 customers a day, but things were about to change. A few minutes later, customer after customer start showing up to buy Randy's product. A whole truck full of strikers even come by asking for some stuff. Yeah, looks like the strike against Amazon is turning into good business for Randy, and soon he will find a way to capitalize on this even more. Next we briefly see Josh and his Amazon box on the news. He's been doing press tours drumming up support for his anti-Amazon pro-socialist cause. Yes, Josh was basically pushing communism in the last episode, and as you'll soon see, this continues to a ridiculous degree here too. Back at the Amazon factory, Butter's dad is teaching the new employees how to work there. The mall mutants haven't had contact with people since Amazon took over all the consumers, so they have a lot of adjusting to do. And I gotta say, the mutants are definitely one of my favorite parts here. The way they pop up from behind things and constantly hiss, especially as they scurry away, just priceless.
I'm your floor manager, Steven Stotch. Being a fulfiller isn't hard. You just follow a few basic steps.
Back at Tegrity Farms, Randy's location, he's getting more customers than ever, but he soon realizes he needs to find a better way to get his product to them, to capitalize on the fact that many more people are smoking because of this Amazon strike. This leads to Randy and Tally devising a plan. They're going to use the e-scooters, the things that almost killed everyone a few episodes ago, earlier this season. Also, of course, Tally is back here. He's come back around because he also returned earlier this season too, when Randy started his weed farm. Tally loves to get high after all, and he's helping Randy with the e-scooter idea now, in order to get some weed off of it, I'm sure. Next, we turn back to Josh in the box, who is turned into a full-blown college communist. He's given a lecture now about anti-capitalism, in fact. His self-proclaimed talk on Marxist theory starts with some bullshit about how the bourgeoisie keeps down the common worker by having them fetishize products. In the crowd, we see Kenny is there too, seemingly forced to watch this commie bullshit since his dad is one of the prominent strikers of Amazon and a supporter of Josh. Yeah, Kenny's family is poor too, so it makes sense for them to go full socialist. They have nothing to lose and everything to gain, and that's the type of demographic communist theories target. Weakened, poor, starving masses. Socialists in America like Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez promise people the world, but of course, they never actually deliver. And communist and socialist countries always turn into shitholes too, don't forget. But there are still some wannabe smart guys out there like Josh, in his box, who tries to make communism look cool, with these snobby speeches saying Marxism works great in theory. theory, but in application it's always a big mess. And I think that's why South Park is making fun of all this now. Many Democrats in America have been going so extreme, they are basically full-blown socialists or communists like this. Again, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, who just got elected to Congress at age 29 after being a bartender a year ago, well, she's the kind of dum-dum who perpetuates this kind of commie bullshit in the real world, in America. And South Park is using the Josh character to goof on socialists on its show now. So I still can't believe how other leftists and people reviewing this show of South Park, I can't believe they thought they were being anti-capitalist, when clearly they're making fun of socialists too. Oh well, of course, capitalism doesn't get by with a free pass here either. A lot of the attacks on materialism and consumerism are related to the bad parts of the extreme, fully free markets. Amped up capitalism that's unrestrained can be bad too. Fortunately, we don't have that here in America. We have plenty of regulations and enough self-control already. People should be smart enough to control their own spending habits, usually, but sometimes they don't, of course. And that brings us back to the Butters storyline. He was getting ready for the bike parade too, and now that his dad is no longer striking, Amazon sent Butters' family all of their boxes, including his bike supplies. Butters then rolls up to another kid to show off his new bike, and, well, we can clearly see how over the top it is. It's covered in gold and diamonds and has add-ons and cup holders, and then Butters presses a button to reveal feathers. He's literally peacocking, and he's also showing us how bad overspending, greed, and showing off can become. This bike scene is the peak of this concept too, and from here Butters and others start to learn how wrong they were for going this far. But the other boys haven't learned their lessons yet. Stan and Co. have actually finished their four-person bike, and it's almost as lavish and over-the-top as Butters. But they soon find out Kenny isn't on board with this idea anymore. Turns out that Marx's speech had an effect on Kenny, and he's the first to realize these materialistic things aren't all they're made out to be. And here's a good place to see both of the extremes of this argument. Kenny is on the far left wing, full-blown communist side, while the other boys are still fully capitalist, free market, and hyper-consumerism types. Soon they eventually meet somewhere in the middle too, which is good. There are of course some good ideas and aspects to both sides of this. While I obviously lean more towards the right wing and towards laissez-faire capitalism, I do acknowledge it has its trappings as well, and socialism can also have a good message at its core sometimes too, but it certainly never worked in application, unlike capitalism. Back in South Park, the boys decide on a new plan. Now that Kenny is off their bike parade team, they no longer want to compete in the contest at all. Instead of just opting out though, which would make them look stupid, the boys decide to try and get the whole bike parade canceled, so everyone loses. Carmen even comes up with the perfect way to do it too, make the bike parade seem offensive. That's how people get other things canceled in 2018, like Roseanne's show on ABC for example. And this also plays off the original theme for this South Park season. The bike parade is an analogy for South Park. They started this season off with that hashtag cancel South Park after all, jokingly saying they would be more offensive this year to try and get themselves canceled. And well, this idea comes back in its finale here too, and it eventually goes on to allude to the South Park show itself specifically. Before we get to that though, first we see Josh the communist has been captured by Jeff Bezos, the capitalist. Josh goes on one last Marxist rant before he gets executed in a pretty ironic way. Bezos sends in a group of kids and tells them that Josh's box has a present for them, and their capitalistic consumer programming prompts the children to rush to the box and try opening it right away. This causes Josh's body to explode, since the box was all that was holding him together. So yeah, the socialist character was literally killed by consumerism. Pretty fitting. Meanwhile, Randy and Tally have been doing great with their weed delivery business. They're using those e-scooters to get around everywhere too, and more people are getting high during the strike as well.
Oh, my weed. Forgot I ordered that. Oh hey, listen, we have an app now. You can keep track of your orders and get your Tegrity delivered even faster. Oh, there's an order now.
Next comes the now infamous Santa Claus scene from this episode. I say that now because there's a certain part here that has some left-wing journalists pretty triggered. Huffington Post even wrote an article about how Santa curses in the South Park episode, and how it's the first time the C-word has been used uncensored on South Park. There was one other TV show in America that said it before, but that was only once and it just happened a year ago, so South Park saying it here is still pretty bold. And although it may just seem like a funny aside, I think they're actually doing it for a good reason too. Let me explain. Towards the end of this episode, Santa shows up to help South Park in its time of need. The thing is though, the first thing Santa asks about is Mr. Hanky, who South Park had previously kicked out of town earlier this season. When Santa figures out they did this because Hanky said a few bad things on Twitter, he immediately bails on South Park, taking off and calling all the townspeople a bunch of C-words. And it makes sense for Santa to stick up for Hanky like that too. Mr. Hanky is the Christmas poo after all. And of course, this is another big callback to wrap up this storyline. A bit. But more importantly, South Park took this time to push the envelope even further, just a little bit here, like how they did with other stories and words in the past, like their infamous shit episode. But now South Park has used the C word, which also ties in with the meta cancel South Park hashtag, as you'll soon see.
He tweeted some inappropriate things.
He tweeted some inappropriate things.
In the end, the boys have a serious, heartfelt thinking session on a beautiful bridge overlooking town. And here's where things get real meta. Carmen says how come everything keeps getting canceled but them. Stan replies asking if they should just keep going on, making asses of themselves. And this is clearly South Park referencing the show itself. They've tried to get canceled with this season's hashtag. They've pushed the envelope time and time again over the years, even using a new curse word in this episode. But no matter what they do, South Park stays around. And this is a good thing too. This is good for us and for them, but clearly the creators, Matt and Trey, they're having a sort of existential crisis about where to go from here. Not in a bad, whiny way, but they're sort of admitting they don't know exactly where to go. Trying to be outlandish and offensive may have reached a critical mass now, but I do have faith in these guys and they will figure it out. Really, I'm not worried at all. This bit was done as a self-referential joke, showing how South Park is pretty much untouchable at this point. And funny enough, in a way, this has made their trying to be offensive shtick become a little old. This leads to the boys confronting Jeff Bezos at the mayor's office, where Bezos immediately orders Alexa to kill Kenny, a quick callback to an old classic South Park joke, and it shows how capitalism kills socialism eventually. Next, Randy can be heard yelling outside the window here. Turns out he's got the whole town with him outside, in order to protest Amazon and Jeff Bezos. Also, let's not forget, Randy has been selling weed to everyone, and we can clearly see the town is high, because their eyes are all red and sleepy looking. Also, in the beginning, the town is so high they are facing the wrong way when they call Bezos out, to which Jeff quickly corrects them. Yes, Jeff Bezos' plan to turn the town into consumer workers has failed here, as they all got over it by getting high off of Tegrity weed. They've got Tegrity, and having some weed does help with stuff like this too, in the real world. It takes the edge off, gets you thinking, and helps people relax. Would certainly help with a protest too, and it would also help get people's minds off of bullshit they don't need from Amazon. Definitely a plus. Finally, things come to a close with a special new song, and of course, the long-awaited bike parade. All the kids ride down the streets on their normal, less tricked out bikes, except Butters, who is still peacocking. And while the kids bike, the parents and adults are all smoking weed while watching. Yes, Tegrity Weed ended up owning up to its name. South Park showed a lot of integrity in this episode, and they also showed a lot of self-referential self-awareness too. It was a good season finale that wrapped up a lot of those loose ends we saw. There was even a brief shot of Mr. Garrison as Trump at the end here. He was shown in police handcuffs for some reason, maybe related to this Mueller trial. Not sure, but it was Trump's first appearance this whole season, I believe. This was probably done as just some kind of inside joke, saying he might get locked up or some other nonsense. I wouldn't think too much into it. And well, that about wraps things up on season 22 of South Park. What did you guys think of this final episode? Did you like the socialist versus capitalist themes? Or what about them goofing on Amazon and Jeff Bezos? And why do you think they had Trump in handcuffs at the end here? Comment your thoughts on everything below, and thanks again for watching No Bullshit. We'll see y'all next time.